So thank you very much. It's an enormous pleasure for me to speak here and to come to St. Petersburg after 15 years, more or less.
Oh, 13 years
is a long time. And when Nikolai asked me to give a talk, it was on reductive group. So I gave a title on the algebra. This will be the talk for tomorrow. Then he asked another talk. And this talk is about something quite different, but I thought that maybe it could interest for more of a colloquium audience, okay? So the talk is about some work which was done by many people, but in particular it kept me and Michel Vergne and Processi busy for various years, and still there are some problems, although at the moment our activity on this work has stopped because maybe we don't meet anymore. And in any case, most of the things I will do are of a more kind of survey level. But if you are interested in more of proofs and things, these are five papers which we published on the subject. So let me explain very quickly what they are about. The first paper, it more or less covers what I'm going to cover in the first half of the talk. It will be the development of certain combinatorics, which originates for a very classical problem, which goes back to, I think, the Indian mathematics, which is the one which I will explain very soon. And then it generalizes to the vector case and it gives a proof of a known theorem in another way. The second is about the surprising discovery, which I very briefly say, that the spaces which we are, or maybe the groups which are going to introduce in the first, in fact compute K theory of certain spaces and give the values, possible values of of the index of a transversely of Euclidean transversely elliptic operator with respect to a commutative compact Lie group. And the other one, it's a generalization to compute cohomology instead of K-theory. The third one is the foundations of a notion of infinitesimal index, which in this transversely elliptic case is more complicated than usual because it produces distributions instead of. And the third one is a kind of proof of a Riemann-Roch type formula for this index. It is again identity of distributions essentially. And so this I will not touch at all about the last two. And as you see, they appeared more or less 2 years ago, and then we, for the moment, there are no developments, also because I tried to do the non commutative case, but in fact the only case I was able to do was SU2, and for any other group I find the combinatorial some problem of invariant theory over the integers, which seems to be extremely difficult to deal with. Okay, and Michel Vergne passed, Processi was always a sort of consultant, and Michel has passed to more geometric things. And so let me start with a very simple problem. So we take n positive integers, and we ask in how many ways we can write a given non-negative integer as a sum of positive integers, but we require that the coefficients are themselves non-negative. So this is some kind of, if they were any integer, it was kind of equations which you do in the first course of algebra, which is to do with the modular arithmetic, more or less. But if you ask them positive, it's slightly more difficult. I always say that it's the problem which is the first not completely trivial problem that you encounter in number theory. So here is a very obvious example in when the sequence is made only of ones. And so we would like to know in how many ways you can partition an integer h in the sum of n different integers. Okay, and the answer is very simple. which of course for some reason. So by division, this is the number of n-tuples of non-negative integers whose sum is h, okay? So this is the dimension of this. Of course, to any such sum, to any such sequence, you associate a monomial in the n variables, x1 to the m1, x2 to the m2, and so on. So, and this gives you a basis of the space of polynomials of degree h. So you compute this, and what you get is this as this dimension. So this is the number of solutions. It's very simple. And I think this is more or less appeared in this work of Indians. This is the appearance of what they call Pascal triangle. In Italy, we call it Tartaglia triangle, which is this number of binomial number. So it's very classical thing. And what we notice that this thing is it's a polynomial in H. You see, polynomial in H. So, in fact, as the polynomial in H has degree n minus 1. So, this thing doesn't work properly, so you will see the same slide many times. I apologize for that, but I cannot do anything about this. There is a problem of computer. So this is also the number of points with integer. So this is a kind of combinatorial interpretation which is going to be relevant for us later on. Number of points with integers scored in the simplex is the intersection of the positive quadrant in Rn with the hyperplanes of equation x1 plus x2 plus xn equal h. This is of course completely trivial. I'm saying a series of trivial facts one after the other. And furthermore, if you write the generating function, this one, and this is just 1 over 1 minus t to the n, okay? So all of this will be generalized in due time. And in fact, some of you could have noticed that one thing I said is wrong, namely that this thing is a polynomial, because it's a polynomial only if h is positive. If h is negative, you get 0. So for the all negative values, you don't get a polynomial. So it's true for positive values, but it's false for negative values. In fact, it's true also for some negative values. And this has to do with cohomology of projective space, in fact, with the coefficients in line bands. Okay. So again, I'm repeating the same because for some reason. So a comment on the statement that the function is given by a polynomial. If you take this polynomial, this is now a polynomial. This polynomial is equal to this function only if h is less than 0. But in fact, slightly more is true. It is equal to this function as soon as h is larger than minus n. And in fact, you can show that this is the unique polynomial of degree n minus 1, which just takes values 0 from minus n plus 1 up to minus 1, and takes value 1 at 0. So in this case, you get the degree plus this initial condition completely characterize this polynomial. And this is a theorem we want to prove later on. Okay? So I repeat, this thing is equal to this polynomial only for h, no, certainly for h larger than 0, but also we extend the validity of this result a little bit in the negative direction, and this is space because we get initial conditions, very simple initial conditions. And if you know a little bit how this cohomology of projective space, you see immediately why this is true. So now let's consider the Pascal triangle. So we take this difference operator, which is just the value of this polynomial minus this, and we get just the next one. And then we go on. And then at the end, we get a polynomial of degree 0. And when you get a degree 0 polynomial, then you iterate again, you get 0, because the difference operator. So after you have, so it's like the n derivative. It's a difference operator which gives the n derivatives. And so, we, in fact, these two facts characterize this polynomial. The first fact just says that the polynomial is degree n minus 1. It's just that the difference operator kills it after n steps. And the second are these initial conditions. On the other hand, our function, which from now on will be called partition function because it gives the way of partitioning an integers in the sum of integers, it's not true that this holds, but this holds. So the, when you apply the nth derivative, you get the function supported only at zero. Okay? And this you can do also for polynomials, you will get the same. And in that case you will get a polynomial, and then when you differentiate you will get a distribution which is just the Dirac distribution at zero. This for people who are interested in the continuous case, which is much easier than this difference case. So in effect, similar statements hold also in the case of arbitrary sequences of propositive integers. The main difference being that PXK is not in general a polynomial, but there is an Italian word which I put there by mistake, but is but a quasi polynomial. This is an Italian word which I don't know why I put. And this has been essentially proven by Cayley in 1857, so it's not very new mathematics. But and since I will give a more precise statement later, I will skip the proof. But I want to show you an example to show you what is a quasi polynomial in words. So we get x equal 2 and 3. And essentially, when you have these numbers, you take the minimum common multiple of all the numbers, and you get a polynomial for each residue class modulo this. So in this case, you will get six polynomials. And each polynomial will give the value of the function on numbers which are congruent to the given one modulo 6, in this case, or modulo the least common multiple. So in this way you get these polynomials. Notice that these polynomials all take integer value on the right residue class. For example, if a number is a multiple of 6, h divided by 6 is integer. If a number is congruent to 1 modulo 3, h minus 1 is divisible by 6, so it's fine. If you get 2 modulo 6, h plus 4 is a multiple of 6, and so on. So although these polynomials have denominators, but they take integral value exactly on the right residue classes, but not on the others. Okay. So the solution is that you have to specify a number of polynomials, or what is called a periodic polynomial, or quasi periodic polynomial, which is essentially a polynomial with coefficients in some periodic exponentials, okay, which specify the. Okay. Okay. So now I think we are spend one quarter of the talk doing some very introductory case. Let's be more ambitious and pass to a more general case. Okay. And this is when you have to use combinatorics. So let's pose a problem, a vector problem, instead of a scalar problem of the same kind. So we take a real vector space of dimension S and inside a lattice. For example, you could take Rs and inside z to the s, okay? Then you take a list x, namely a sequence with possible repetitions of elements in lambda. So in our case, we were taking r and z, and a list was just a sequence of numbers. Okay, now we assume for simplicity that x generates V as a vector space, otherwise we take the span and we reduce the thing. And then, remember, in the first case, we were assuming that the numbers were all positive. Namely, we said that they were lying on the same side of a hyperplane. Of course, in one dimension, there is only one hyperplane, which is the origin. So it means that they lie on the same side of the origin. So we put the same condition. So we say that there is a linear function such that it takes positive value on each of them. So all these vectors lie in the same side, okay? And then in this case, we can expand this polynomial formally as this sum, when lambda is any element in lambda. So we expand in one direction, and since all the vectors lie in the same direction of u, you very easily prove that this thing makes sense. And this gives you the coefficients they call the partition function on associated to our set. So for any a lambda, this function just computes the number of ways you can write lambda as a linear combination with positive coefficients by this formula of elements in the list. Okay, so you get a function which from lambda to the non-negative integers, maybe zero sometime. Okay. So these states of Manilae can be written in this way. And notice that if s equal 1, we are exactly, we have just made a completely safe translation of the one-dimensional case without any ambition, okay? Okay, now we are in trouble. Now what should I do? No, I think maybe I have to go here. Sorry. Okay, notice that, let us consider now the cone generated by this, just the linear combination with positive coefficients. So we have this vector, so you know, something in the plane, we would say, three vectors like this, they all lie on the same side of a line. Then you take the cone. Okay. So, of course, if you are outside the cone, you cannot write any vector as a linear combination with positive coefficients of this, because the cone is exactly the locus where these are linear combination with positive coefficients. So we take this pointed cone, which is pointed because of the assumption, and then we get that if we are outside the cone, we get zero. Not very intelligent remark, but still something. So, and now I don't know what happens. Ah, okay. Now, furthermore, we could consider the map from R to dx, so a very large spectral space of dimension equal to the number of elements in this list, which is at least n because they span, at least s because they span v, which is all dimension. And just we define in this way. And then it's easy to see that px lambda equals the number of points with integers coordinates in the convex polytope, which is just the preimage of lambda intersected with the positive quadrant. This is also a completely trivial fact, but I mean it's important because essentially any polytope defined by integer inequalities, even not having integer vertices, can be written this way. So in a way, if we could solve this problem, we could have a way of computing integer points inside say integral convex polytope, integral in the sense that they are defined by integer inequalities. Of course, this will be not very valid this way from the point of view of computationally, because there are, given a single polytope, there are very quick algorithms to compute the number of due to Barbinov. Okay. So this is just qualitative. I mean, we want to say if you know a few one, how to know all the others, which is something different. Okay. So as in the case of TOT, we want to say something on the qualitative properties of this function. So we don't want to give away, I mean, we want to give away of computing, but it will be a lengthy and not very efficient way. But if we compute it, like in the case of 2 and 3, we will have a formula which is valid for any lambda. Okay, so, and now is the moment of introducing combinatorics, because in fact, this thing is solved or met using combinatorics, and in fact, these combinatorics, most of these combinatorics come from a different subject of which I know very little, which is approximation theory, numerical analysis. It was studied by people doing something called box splines, although I have nothing to say about this. So we introduce a remarkable zonotope, which the zonotope is just the linear combinations, with these TA are be taken in the interval 0, 1. For example, in our example, we get, I think, an hexagon, something like that. We get an hexagon, very badly written, but it's still an hexagon, okay? And but these are remarkable polytopes. They are not very arbitrary. They are union of parallelepipeds. Okay. And also we set Sx as the set of B subsequences B, such that B does not span V. So they span a smaller space. And Y, the union of cones over this set B. So they are small cones which are more or less faces of the big cone. And then we take R to be the complement. And then R, it's called the set of regular points. And Y is called the set of singular points, not very surprisingly. And a connected component of R is called a big cell. So a big cell is just a connected component of this. So in this case, for example, I would have, I write this picture again. I would have this big cell, this big cell, and this big cell, because I would have to take the positive half lines spanned by this and remove them. Okay? So I would get three big cells. The relevant one, of course, are this one, these two, because this is outside and we know everything about the behavior of the function. Okay. If we remove the whole span, so in this case we remove the three lines, not just the three half lines, we get more connected components. They are called tope. Okay, there's more connected component. You may ask, maybe in the relevant cone they are the same, but they are not, as the following example shows. So this is a root system of type A3. So I draw here a spherical, the intersection of the cone with the sphere. So I get in the intersection of the cone with the sphere this triangle with these three special points. And so I get seven big cells, which are these. On the other hand, if I drive, you see, but if I have to drive a linear span, I have also to go down here. So you get one more. So if I take tope, I get eight tope. So let me say that even for a root system of type APN, I am not able to know how many big cells there are. I mean, I know how to construct them, but I don't know whether there is a nice formula to enumerate these big cells. But these are very natural combinatorial objects associated to root system. Okay. Okay, so now we have to say finally what is a quasi-polynomial, periodic polynomial, which is what we... So a quasi-polynomial is a function on the lattice lambda, and it's called a quasi-polynomial if we can find a sublattice of finite index such that the restriction to each gamma coset, gamma plus lambda, is a polynomial. So exactly like before, we had the sublattice the multiple of 6, and then we restrict to the quotient of z mod the multiple of 6, we get 6 cosets, and on each you want a polynomial. Okay, equivalently, it's a linear combination of polynomials multiplied by periodic exponential. This is just a reformulation. Okay, so now let me state the theorem, the analog to the theorem of Cayley. And this is for a proof, but not the first proof, you can, which is not very hard. No proof is very hard. You can find, you can look at our first paper. So let's see a big cell, then there is a quasi-polynomial Pxc, such that Px lambda equals Pxc lambda, for each lambda in the big cell minus Bx. So now I have to explain you what is minus bx, because otherwise you don't understand what it is. It's not that you take c and you remove bx, but you take the difference of elements in c and bx. So minus bx means, so this is important fact, c minus bx is the set of V of the form U minus W, such that U lies in C and W lies in Bx. So in this case, we take this big cell, and then we take the hexagon, but we put it in the opposite, because you have to, so you have this hexagon, whatever it is, because I will, and then I take the, all the points which are difference of this and this. Of course, this is contained, because the hexagon contains zero, so you could take W equal to zero, so all the points in C are there, but there are more points. So it's a big fat set, okay? So this is C by minus Bx by definition. This is important because, again, so in the case we considered before of the polynomial, Bx was the interval 0, n, so C minus Bx is just all the points which are greater than the minus n, because you have to take positive points minus a point which is greater than minus n. So just the open half line starting with minus n. So it's exactly the set where we found that this was a polynomial. This is really the generalization of two n dimensions of the theorem we stated of the Cayley result. Okay, so let me give you a little bit of history of this theorem from the point of view of who proved it. This is not, I mean, I was not an expert, I was just meeting Michel Vergne from time to time, so I don't take complete responsibility of the historical facts, but this is what I gathered speaking with them. So apparently this theorem in this generality was proven by Senesch and Vergne in 2003. And this was proven by making repeated expansions in partial fraction of the partition function. On the other hand, we could consider, instead of big cells, the smaller tope. We have seen that tope are really smaller. So if you prove a theorem about tope, you prove less than about big cells, because you would get more polynomials, one for each tope. And this statement was proven by two Damen, and in Italian this would be called Michelli, but it's not Italian, it's American, they call it Michelli, probably of Italian origin, in 1988. And these people are really very, were rather famous numerical analysts, and they were looking to theory of approximation, and they introduced these tools. I must say that the proof we gave is greatly inspired by these two guys. And as I said, the ideas come from approximation theory. Okay. So what's next? Okay. So a key point is the use of difference operators. We have seen this through the use of Pascal triangle. So now let me do again a little bit of combinatorics and introduce these difference operators. So we take a function f on lambda, and we define, and we take a vector in lambda, the difference over of the value in lambda and the value in lambda minus a. Okay. Now, I think, hopefully this will be essentially the last combinatorial tool I introduce. We take the, we say that the subspace in V is x-rational if R is generated by the elements of X inside R. For example, in this case, there are exactly four rational subspaces, the whole space, this line, this line, this line, and the origin, four at all. Okay. So, given a rational subspace, we set nabla of X minus R just the product of the difference operator relative to the elements which are not in R, in X but not in R. So the ones which are out. So in this example, if we take this vector, you call it A, B, and suppose this vector is A plus B, then we get to this line we associate delta B delta A plus B, to this line delta A delta B, and to this line we associate delta A delta A plus B, and to the origin we associate delta A delta B delta A plus B, and to the whole space we are just associating the identity because we have, there is nothing to be associated. Okay. You have a problem?
Not delta, but
number. Because I'm stupid. You are right. You are perfectly right. I apologize. Okay. Okay, so you have nabla, okay? So now I state the result, which is, if you do it in terms of generating function, is completely trivial. It just says that if you multiply some of the elements in the denominator and you cancel them. Mm-hmm. So this is totally trivial fact. And this, in terms of the partition function, has the following consequence. For a very rational size space R, if you apply nabla of x minus R to P of x, you get a function which is supported in the subspace. It just says this. If you translate in terms of generating function, it says this. It's a trivial fact. You agree? More or less. Okay. It's trivial fact. Homework, homework. You are young people, homework. Okay. But it's just, you have a dictionary going from generating function to function, and you just say that. Okay. So we discovered that this function has a lot of restriction of support type restriction, like the partition function had this Pascal triangle, that when you apply this difference operator at the end, we were supported only at the origin. This is a support restriction for any of these subspaces. Okay. So this suggests the following. To introduce this strange subspace, the space of integer variable function on lambda with the property that for every rational subspace R, this has support in R. So of course this is a space. In fact, it's an abelian group. In fact, a free abelian group. And of course, the partition function lies in it by what we have proven with this very complicated lemma before. Okay, and then this, we just take the span of this over the group ring of lambda, which is just the set of functions with finite support. Okay, this is just to enlarge it to make it, instead of an abelian group, a module over the Laurent polynomials. I mean, it's just a technical point which unfortunately enters at the end, and so I put the definition here. It will not be used, and maybe won't be used because you throw me out before, but you will see. Okay. So this just said that it's Z lambda modulated by this, and since Z lambda considered finitely supported function. Okay. So let us observe that a quasi polynomial P in F tilde is necessarily a solution of the set of equations. So if this is a quasi polynomial, by simple continuity arguments, this guy is really, if it is supported somewhere, it is a quasi polynomial, it must be zero if it is supported in a proper subspace. So this quasi polynomial is just a solution of this thing. Maybe I should have said for every properly contained rational subspace. Not, of course, okay, properly contained. Okay. So we can define DM is the space of integer variable functions such that for every rational subspace properly contained, sorry, this was a mistake in preparing the talk, properly contained. This thing is zero, because if I say it for the for x itself, R just the whole space, it means that f is zero, which I don't want. So this means so add in your notes, properly contained, R properly sorry. Okay? Okay, so we have this space, and then we work a little bit. Oh, the DM is for Damen and Michelli, and we work a little bit, and we say this subspace or subgroup is in fact made all of quasi polynomial, and this DM is the space of quasi polynomial in f of x. So the space of all quasi polynomial in f of x is exactly the space which do not satisfy the support condition, but satisfy the actual equations, difference equations. Okay. Okay. And then this is an historical remark, namely that DM, this space has been introduced by Damen and Michelli in 88, and this space was introduced much later. It was introduced. I think I got a letter from Michel Vergne 3 or 4 years ago, no, maybe 4, 5 years ago, introducing this space. So I made a bit of historical trick, but it doesn't matter. Okay, so these are a free abelian group of finite rank. Rank of the, and the interesting point, the rank of DM equals the volume of the zonal of Bx, while fx is rank equal to the sum of the volume of the various zonotopes. The volume of a fundamental domain for the lattice lambda is normalized to B1. So this is by definition, okay? So this is the way we compute the volumes, okay? This number is interesting because it has to do with it doesn't matter, okay. It can be computed. So now we want to use to show that DM, the quasi polynomiality of P of X. And so the idea is this, the idea is to give a tope, so we start with a tope. So we find a way to push F of X inside DM of X. Precisely, given a tope and a function f, there exists a quasi polynomial ft of in dm such that these two coincide. So we don't want to prove the theorem for the partition function, we want to prove a more general theorem for any tope in this space, for any function in this space, but restricted to the tope, not to the big cells. And in fact, this theorem is not true for any function. It's true, the general theorem is not true for any function, it's true only on the tope. And if f is px, the partition function, we have to show that if we have two adjacent topes, and which lie in the same big cells, then the two functions we obtain in this way coincide, hence they define the same function, okay? The two polynomials coincide. And so to really get the result on big cells, we need to prove, we prove a general result on tope for any function, and then we prove a sort of wall crossing formula or wall crossing identity for the polynomial, the quasi polynomial associated to partition function to distinct tope. So it really requires some more work. Okay, so this is what we prove. So this repeats what I already said. And then notice that our system automatically satisfies that f tau automatically satisfies our system of difference. Sorry. Okay. No, this was the same. It was the right one. How much satisfy the system of difference equation and slice in the Damen Michelli. So we don't have to prove that lies. Okay, so what this one does is the following. One shows by making clever convolutions with partial partition function, which I don't want to explain, that if we fix a tope, you have a canonical way of identifying f of x with the direct sum of this Damen Michelli space. Okay. So by this I mean that this isomorphism of free abelian groups of finite rank, so it's highly non-canonical, but it's becomes canonical as soon as you choose the topic. So you have a natural filtration of this, and you can split canonically this filtration once you have chosen a topic. Once you have this, you take M tau, just the preimage of everything except the Damian Michelli space. So you, here you have a lot of these guys. You take all for properly contained spaces. And then the theorem is that these two is the direct sum, is part of this. And if M lies in N, then F is identically zero on tau minus Bx. Again, minus Bx is important, in the same sense as I said before. So the technique is you take this filtration, which is canonical, and as Olivier knows very well, splitting filtrations is something not so easy to do, but if you choose the topic, you automatically have convolution operators which allow to go back and split canonically this. And once you have done this, you are done. Okay. So this can imply the theory team sending F equal writing F as F tau plus F1. Where F1 is M tau and F tau is in the M, because this vanishes and this is a quasi polynomial and we are done. So as I said, this is not an R theorem, but I wanted to save this surprising application to other things, so I will skip any other detail essentially. As I said, one needs a wall crossing formula, and this is one has to work a little bit. And okay, so let me now explain the analog of the initial conditions, and this is obtained as follows: one takes a vector v in C, which is very, very close to the origin. Remember that you have this big cell, which is a cone, and we take a tiny vector very close to the origin. Instead of taking minus the zonotope, you move it a little bit. Okay, you translate by this very tiny vector. So you consider v minus b. So this zonotope, this here, the nice chalk is where. Ah, okay. So you had this zonotope, and then you had these three things. And then if you want, once you have chosen this vector, this zonotope, you translate it here. So you move it a little bit in the positive direction. So this vector must be really tiny. But then you discover a wonderful fact that this zonotope has exactly as many points. This translated zonotope as the dimension of dmx, and each of these integer points gives an independent condition on dmx. So if you impose conditions on this point, you get only one solution. Okay. So this is something you have to prove, but it's... So the quasi-polynomial which coincides with the Cartesian in CVI is the unique element of dmx such that, this is a surprise party, because such that P of x is zero on each non-zero point in this translated zonotope is one in this, which is exactly the analog of the characterization. I'm very proud of this. I mean, I like it very much. Although it's useless because you have to compute a lot of things. Okay, and then compute this space DM. So solve incredible, great amount of difference equation. Then impose the initial condition, solve, usually there are a lot of points in this thing, so you have a linear system with integer coefficients with a lot of unknown, solve it by, I don't know, Cramer rule, like that, and it takes infinite, I mean, from the point of view of efficiency, of complexity, this is not efficient, but it's a really closed solution of the problem. Okay, So now we are going to change subject altogether, and we go to another subject that has to do with Michel Vergne in a way, in many ways, and which is index theory. So in fact, what turns out to surprise that these spaces, this f of x, in fact, this f tilde of x, the ones enchanted by the the function with finite support, so the Z lambda module, appear in a different context. So for explaining this, I need a detour. So this detour will be essentially words. I mean, I will not be very precise. And so we start with a compactly group. And in this talk will be a torus. So the tachyloidal group is a lattice. And this you, we see coming. In fact, let me say that the real, for doing inductions, it's better to take a compact commutative Lie group, not necessarily connected, because otherwise, because of index of lattices. But I don't want to enter in these technicalities. I mean, I don't want to. And then we take a manifold, a symphinity, say, manifold, with a symphinity action of a compact Lie group G. And one can introduce, this was introduced by Attia and Singer, the notion of transversely elliptic operator between two equivalent vector bundles. This is a pseudo-differential operator from the space of smooth sections of the first to the space of smooth section of the second, which commutes with the action of G, and is elliptic in a very sort of weak way, namely in the directions transversal to the orbits of G. So this means the following. You take the cotangent bundle of the manifold, P the projection, and inside this cotangent bundle you take, this is not some set, I would like to be some set, but it's subset. It is the automatic correction of the Macintosh that likes sunset better than subset. And then this goes upset, whose fiber in a point is formed by all the cotangent vector which vanish on the tangent space to the G orbit in X. So this is a distribution of cotangent subspaces which varies according to the dimension of the orbit of the point. So it can go up and down a lot. For example, in the origin is always everything. In other points, so this is an extremely singular space, okay? I mean, in general, you know. So I don't have time, but you get some interesting quadrics of low rank, real quadrics. It's a very real, real space. It can be interpreted also at the zero set of a moment map, but I mean, I don't want to say that. So now, by a symbol, one means a smooth section of this bundle, of the pullback bundle. And then, so it's just a linear map from the fiber in X to the fiber in X depending continuously on a cotangent vector. And then this is transversely elliptic is whenever Xi lies here, this map is almost always an isomorphism. So it's an isomorphism outside a compact subset. So usually you would have all of this and say the isomorphism outside a compact subset. Here you just happy by saying that it's an isomorphism outside a compact subset, but only in the transversal directions. So to this you define a class in the K-theory group, K0G of this guy. And then the important thing, which I don't know whether I wrote, is that you can associate an index to this class as follows. So you take the set of equivalent classes of finite dimensional modules. This G is at all just the character group, so it's the lattice lambda. Then you take the group of Z-valued function on G. And then the index map associated to a transversal elliptic operator A, an element consisting as constructed as follows. So, you see, in general, when you have a sorry, no, when you have, when, no, sorry, when you have an elliptic operator, the kernel of this map is finite dimensional. Then you take the adjoint operator and the kernel of the adjoint is finite dimensional, and the index is the difference. But now, our condition is too weak to assure that it's finite dimensional. So, but still, the kernel of this map is a representation, because this is an equivalent map. So you could say if the multiplicity of every reducible representation is finite, because then you would have a function which gives to any irreducible representation an integer number, so a function on the group of irreducible representation. So if you could ask that for any irreducible representation, the multiplicity of that irreducible representation in the kernel and in the kernel of the adjoint is finite, you would have a number, a sequence of numbers, one for each irreducible. So this is what happens. This is why Atiyah and Singer introduce. So for every t, om g of tau care a is finite dimension of dimension some number m. The same is true for the adjoint. And so we have defined an index, which is just the value in an irreducible is just the difference of the two. So in case of a torus, we have defined a function on a lattice. And now we know we have a lot of spaces of functions on a lattice. We are very happy and we hope that they are related. Okay, in the first part of the talk we have given this and we are very excited. So, ho ho, let's hope. And in fact, they are the same. So this, so one of the, this is really the heart of index theory. So the fact that the symbol, the way I define the index is using the operator, but it really depends only on the symbol. So you have a homomorphism of modules over the character group from this to this set of functions. So in the case, suggest that the problem of computing can be reduced, at least theoretically, to the case in which G is a torus for a given manifold M, one embeds M. So this is where the combinatorics breaks down. You know, this tells you that if you take a sort of splitting principle, in principle you can compute the index by going to a torus, but you don't know exactly what you get. So it's a very implicit thing. But implicit, for a given manifold, oh, I don't know, what is this? It's not pornographic.
Just stop this message.
Okay. I am almost through, don't worry. How long? I still have 5 minutes because we were late. I have maybe 3 slides.
Ten more minutes.
So I will even be early. Okay, okay, we want to compute for a given manifold and we embed the manifold in a linear representation and then by taking direct image and some technicalities which we will ignore today, you reduce in fact to compute for a linear representation where M is a linear representation. Okay, this is a series of, there is a nice book by Atiyah, this is I think Lecture Notes in Mathematics 714, if I remember correctly, from 79, where you can learn what is a pseudo-differential operator, what is all this thing, and you read this small book and you learn. Okay, so now we can do, what can we do? What we can do is to try to do it when G is a torus. Okay, so in this nice book, which I think is not in 74, but maybe in 78, Atiyah treats the case of S1, of the circle group. And the case of S1 is essentially the case of Cayley, because the lattice is rank 1. And of course, the only rational subspace is the origin, everything is very mild. It was about 30 pages. Using a lot of commutative algebra and so on, and then at the end he found the solution. And then he writes that for a circle, the results are also quite explicit. However, for the general case, we give only a reduction process, and one might hope for something explicit. This probably requires the development of an appropriate algebraic machinery involving cohomology but going beyond it. I don't know what it meant, but in any case. So, no, for reasons which I think, because I must say that when we solved this problem, I was very excited, but then I discovered nobody cares about this problem. So probably nobody really tried to solve it. We were the only one. And so I don't claim that it's really, but in any case, what you need is the introduction of all this machinery coming from approximation theory. So zonotope, the difference equation, rational subspaces, and then you work not too much using just functorial property of the index and computing the index of one pseudo differential operator, essentially only one due to Bott, and then you get indeed the key problem is the combinatorics of this. You work very little, and then if we assume that this has dimension s, the first thing we have to, we had a sequence of vectors which lied on one side of one side of a hyperplane. Now, how are the representations of torus, of compact torus? Well, real irreducible representation can be of two types. There is either they are one dimensional, which are just trivial, and then there are representations of dimension two, and these are given, they can complexified to be a one dimensional representation in two possible ways. Either you take a vector in one direction, you take the conjugate vector which goes in the other direction. Okay, so the signs are not so important, because if we need to change, we change. The result we are looking for is a result which is real, so we start with a real plane and then we choose the complex structure as we more prefer. So we can assume that M contains no trivial component. This is essentially trivial. This was also in Atiyah book. And then we can choose a complex structure on X. X is very horrible because it was the sequence of on M of X, not on X, on M of X, such a way that there is an isomorphism of complex G modules. This is important to have real representation, the whole result is real, so that we can and all contained in an half space. Because if we are unlucky, we just take the conjugate and we change the complex structure. And then we prove. And then we introduce two filtrations, one on M with according to the dimension of the orbit, and the other one on this Fi are those F which are such that the difference operator is zero for every rational subspace of dimension less than I. So these are a filtration, topological filtration, and this is algebraic filtration. And then we have that this is the open set where the stabilizers are finite, and these are this is open set stabilizer finite is, okay, this is completely wrong, it's this is okay, this is okay, and then this inclusion of open set, this is inclusion of subspaces. And then the miracle is that K1 of this, all these spaces is zero, and the symbol is and the index is an isomorphism between K0 of these spaces and C lambda. So in conclusion, it's an isomorphism onto Fi tilde of X. So in conclusion, this F tilde of X, the union of all these tilde of X, are exactly all the possible functions on a lattice which are index of some operator. And not only, if the operator is realized in a vector space, this operator is unique, essentially. Okay. Not the operator, the symbol of the operator is unique. Okay. So this is, of course, so you could say that these spaces are horribly complicated. They have torsion, I mean, they are very complicated, as a Z lambda module. So in a way you could say, well, but then sometimes in mathematics what you have to do is to translate topology into combinatorics, and then the combinatorics is as hard as topology, but you still are happy because you have done an equivalence of two unknown things. Okay. So this is what we did. So as I said, we don't know how to do it with the group. Essentially, we know that what you should get is some invariance under this F tilde. Unfortunately, the invariant, and this is holds if you tensor with Q, but if you do it over Z, we don't know how to, if every invariant is an index. We don't know how to produce. So this remained open in the last 3 years, and then we more or less, I more or less went on retirement, and that's all. I think I am in time. Okay, so thank you very much.